Dan Moore here. We're going to continue talking about canoe hull designs in this video, where we left off in the last one, talking about the four basic hull designs being the flat bottom, the round bottom, the V bottom, and the shallow arch and cross section. Now, reviewing from the last video, we talked a lot about the flat bottom and the round bottom and how they compared in stability. The flat bottom being very good in initial stability, which means when that boat sits in the water and you sit in it, it has a very solid feel, kind of like a floating dock, where the round bottom boat is a very tippy, canoey feel. That's because it lacks that good initial stability that you find in the flat bottom boat. And we talked about secondary stability, which is when that boat is heeled over. The flat bottom boat, difficult to get heeled over. Once it heels over, it'll reach a certain point on the chine when suddenly and unexpectedly it'll just turtle. The round bottom boat with the flared sides, as it heels over, it'll gain in stability. Being initially tippy, it'll gain and become more and more solid right up to the point where that gunwale touches the water. These two boats, the V bottom, the shallow V, and the shallow arch, are a compromise between these boats. Let's remember, anytime we're talking about hull design and looking at gaining an advantage by manipulating that hull, we're going to have to give something up somewhere. A good example, this shallow V design. The shallow V will give you a great advantage in tracking ability, which means that that boat will travel straighter across the lake with less effort to correct it than will a flat bottom boat. Just an aside, you'll see I added a keel on this flat bottom boat. You won't often see keels on modern canoes. If you do see them, it's usually because it's needed for strength in that hull. Either the material or the form of the canoe is not in and of itself strong enough, and so a keel is added to give it some strength. Now, a keel will help you track across the flat water. It'll help the boat go a little straighter, that the action of that keel. It'll also make it more difficult to turn. And also it leaves an appendage hanging on the bottom of your canoe to hang on rocks. And I think most experienced canoeists would prefer not to have a keel. And like I say, you don't often see them on modern boats except as a structural feature. In the shallow V, that V acts somewhat like a keel in giving you that tracking ability, but what you're going to be giving up is maneuverability. It's not going to turn quite as easily. Whereas in the shallow arch, it won't track quite as well as the V bottom boat, but it will be more maneuverable. And what you're often going to find is a combination. The boat may start out with a very fine entry, which comes back into a shallow V, eventually turning into a shallow arch by the center of the boat and then mirroring to the back. So these boats are very common boats. They are a good compromise between these boats. They have good initial stability and good secondary stability. Of course, the flared side on this boat will give you better secondary stability than the tumble home on this boat. The tumble home will give you better ease of reaching your paddle over the edge to perform your strokes correctly. Again, everything is a compromise. Another thing we want to talk about is the depth of the boat. How much freeboard that boat has. The deeper the boat is, the greater its carrying capacity is going to be. All things being equal, if you add width, you also would add carrying capacity. But as you add depth, you'll gain that carrying capacity. It'll be better at shipping waves off the side, whereas a lower one would let water in sooner. So you're gaining in those areas, but what you're giving up is you're adding weight because the boat has more material to it, and you're adding boat above the waterline to catch wind. And so you're going to have more effect by the wind with the higher freeboard than you will with the narrow one. Again, everything is a compromise. You give, you take. And to find the perfect canoe is really something that can't be done You might find the canoe that works best for you and your situation after you've made all the compromises that you need. But no one canoe will do everything. Width. How wide a canoe is, again, it'll add to its initial stability. It will add to its carrying capacity. It'll also add weight. Plus, it'll make it more difficult to push through the water because it's going to have more wetted surface, more water touching the boat, therefore more friction. The shallow arch has a little less wetted surface than the shallow V. The round bottom, less wetted surface than any of these boats, and the flat bottom has the most wetted surfaces. And as you make it wider, that wetted surface increases. And so there is what's called a frictional wave current that's created by your wetted surface. The more wetted surface you have, the more friction is created in the water. Water against boat. Again, how fair the surface is important there too. A nice smooth surface on the side of your canoe will have less frictional drag than something with a rough surface. So you want a boat that's fared nicely. Again, back to the width, the wider boat is going to push a bigger wave. Now, which is faster, a narrow boat or a fast boat? Well, a narrow boat is going to be easier to paddle through the water because you're pushing a smaller wave than a wider boat. However, the potential speed of a boat is entirely determined in a canoe, is entirely determined by its load waterline length. And I'll show you why here.